needless to say, we do believe that the non-negotiable principles around everything that we do center around economic justice, environmental justice, as well as social justice within agriculture. And talking about organic farming, though the topic is supposed to have been organic farming markets, for ASHA, organic farming and the need to advocate for organic farming is not just centered around markets. Markets come a bit later in a sense. For us, it is about a livelihoods approach. It is about food safety approach. And I don't mean just for an elite consumer market, but food safety for the most malnourished in this country. And it's a social equity approach. We do believe that agroecological approach is probably the only way by which farming solutions will really work for the invisible and the most marginalized farmers in the country. I just want to state my bias up front that our beginning point is farming households and not necessarily consumers. Whereas when you talk about markets, very often it could begin at that end also. Just a couple of slides on the overview related to organic farming markets in India. There's really no data available on how much organic farming gets done in this country. What gets counted is only certified organic. That's the only data system that exists in the country. And it is estimated that uncertified organic farming, if organic farming were to be defined as a certain set of principles, let's say no synthetic chemical usage and farming that understands the agroecology under the soil and above the soil, then there's supposed to be an equal number of farmers who are supposed to be organic, but that data doesn't actually exist. We are supposed to have the largest number of organic farmers in the world, and the certified organic area that one last counted is about 27.5 lakh hectares. And you can imagine how much that is in India's net zone area, you know, which is usually around 141 million hectares. Most of it is certified under what is called the NPOP system, National Program on Organic Production, which is under Ministry of Commerce. It's a third party certification system, and this count and these figures are coming from there. But in the recent past, from the time Mr. Modi became the Prime Minister in 2014, the area of organic farming has increased quite substantially. Whether we like it or not, the earlier governments just did not believe, for either the cow reason or any other reason, in agroecological approaches. They would usually respond by saying we'll have food scarcity issues, we'll have productivity issues if we shift large scale to organic farming. But this government has invested on it. There's been a substantial increase. But the long and short of it is that despite some progress, what we have as organic is minuscule. And in terms of the food market value in India, what gets sold as organic is less than 1%. And we have a variety of marketing approaches that are out there. And any diversity that you want to see, any innovation that you want to see with regard to markets of any kind related to agriculture, I think the organic world has already pioneered it, has already experienced it, is way ahead of the conventional markets. We've had contract farming for the longest time in the organic farming world, for instance. Direct marketing for the longest time. We have CSA models where groups of farmers are directly selling to groups of consumers by even taking advance payments in cities like Bangalore. So we had a great diversity of approaches in markets when it comes to organic. in terms of what's the state up to, what are public policies up to when it comes to organic, you would find that on the research and education front, and you all are familiar with this, the extension departments don't do anything with farmers unless it has the blessing from above, from the research system. It's a highly top-down hierarchy. The research that happens in labs and in campuses, in research stations, is supposed to be the body of knowledge that farmers deserve or you know, need to know about. And therefore, if you look at that paradigm of what is happening in the agriculture research and education field, you find that in the recent past, there's been one ICAR institute which actually got announced when Sikkim declared itself fully organic. You know, we've had a big event, if you remember, with the Prime Minister going to Sikkim. And so that's when the National Organic Farming Research Institute was started in Sikkim. We have here in Gujarat the first organic farming university ever in India, which was announced about three budgets ago by the then Chief Minister, before Mr. Vijaybhai Rupani, Anandiben. And we have several specialized institutes for organic farming in state agriculture universities now. This is how far, as far as the research and education component is concerned. We have a ICAR network project which is in its 11th year of checking out whether organic farming has benefits or disadvantages vis-a-vis conventional chemical farming. In 40 centers, they have been doing a systematic research project. And interestingly, this study shows that except for wheat, there's absolutely no worry in any crop when it comes to organic production. I'm trying to preempt those questions that are usually asked as soon as a presentation is made on organic production. What about yields? Will India suffer in terms of production and so on? The one large multi-state, multi-year research project that runs within the government setup is showing that wheat does pose a problem, but other crops have a slight decline initially, not all crops, but they perform better than the inorganic systems. We have a couple of flagship programs now at the Government of India level. You know about it. The yield doesn't make up. It's still it's a big range of yield difference between organic and inorganic. In centers in South India like Dharwad and so on, organic wheat outperforms. But up in Punjab, organic wheat is still 40 to 50% compared to inorganic wheat. So we have flagship programs like the Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana and a flagship program that's called MOVCDNER, quite a mouthful there. Both started in 2015, that's meant specifically for Northeast India. And these have received more than 1500 crore outlays. Which, you know, one is having to say strongly, emphatically, because these kinds of amounts were never seen as budgetary outlays in the earlier years. Several states have organic farming policies, and Gujarat also has one. There are some states which actually have legislation around banning agrochemical sales in their effort to promote organic farming. And there are some states which have included an organic approach into a mainstream agriculture policy. And Andhra Pradesh has the most ambitious agroecological program currently, which is called the Community Managed Natural Farming Program, CMNF, which they want to take to scale throughout the state in another 4 years' time. When BT cotton got approved in India, there was actually a decline in the overall cotton production. I want to flag that as an issue, that GM contamination left its impact on organic area and its expansion. And to this day, the overwhelming extension messaging is around chemical farming. It's not around organic. So the public policy concerns that I want to flag are centered around organic production and support systems, because you can't quite think about markets just evolving by themselves without a production of organic produce happening somewhere. There's some things that I want to flag around the schemes and programs that are running today. A few things on what's happening with investments on organic markets. But I will dwell for at least 5 minutes on a new development around organic market regulation that has emerged from the Food Safety Authority, FSSAI, that I think is a major public policy concern at this point of time for emerging organic markets. On the organic production front, many of you are probably familiar with it, that the approach, the overall approach that the government has is essentially to immediately translate organic farming into schemes. There is no overall approach of agroecology in the way farming is promoted, in the way farming is supported. So you have a large chemical agriculture paradigm where the subsidy regime is all centered around perverse incentives, if you like, around excessive water usage, around excessive chemical usage, around a particular kind of external dependency that has its connection to indebtedness increasing, you know, often pushing farmers to the brink of suicides in particular pockets of the country. And there's hardly anything that you can say about an approach that is around organic production. And I think that structural problem is what drives various other things that go wrong with, you know, what happens within the state setup when it comes to promotion of organic production. And you find that the organic, the agriculture research establishment and the agriculture education establishment has not caught up with postmodern science of agroecology. You really find a dearth of understanding around microbiology, for instance. Researchers and others just don't understand what is the soil ecosystem that is at work in organic production. There's a big black box, if you like, as to why certain practices are actually resulting in a certain outcome for farmers. And you only find scientists saying, this is not possible. You've not given enough nitrogen, so I don't believe the farmer who's saying that she got some 10 quintals of finger millet or something. And disbelief is what drives the research establishment, because the scientific understanding around what actually happens between a set of practices and a set of outcomes that farmers are experiencing, it's become a black box. It's unknown to the extension system and the research system. So they really don't want to believe that something is happening, that farmers are having good experiences with organic farming or agroecology in general. There are no organic farming policies in most states of India, and they don't have any mention even within agriculture policies, and there's certainly no targets. In fact, PKVY as a central scheme got hijacked by one state, which did about 40% or 45%, which is Andhra Pradesh, of the entire PKVY outlay. So most states actually are not interested in picking up budgets that exist with the center either. And I would say that regulatory failures with regard to other agricultural technologies also come in the way of organic production. So I'll just say what I've already said, that agroecology doesn't become an overall approach. It quickly degenerates itself into a few schemes. And what's wrong with those schemes? Despite 20, 25 years of experience around organic schemes, we still have these flagship programs, both of Government of India as well as some states like government of Karnataka, which Karnataka has had state level schemes for the longest time, from 2004 onwards. These are designed as 3-year schemes, and they involve civil society groups for implementation as service providers. And they say that, you know, for 3 years, you give me your list of farmers who you are going to shift to organic. After 3 years, there's a drive to say, okay, the scheme here is over. Move on to a new set of farmers and a new set of villages. And we are actually finding that farmers are dropping out of the initiation into organic farming practices and go back to the chemical paradigm, because this kind of a shift, which is basically a de-addiction program, if you like, doesn't take place in 3 years. You need to do hand-holding for at least 5 to 10 years. I would say 7 to 10 years. And the schemes are still designed as 3-year schemes. Similarly, in the PKVY program, the cost components are skewed towards direct benefit transfer, saying that, okay, the chemical farmer receives on an average about 5,000 rupees just on chemical fertilizer subsidy on an average at the national level. So we'll give you an equal amount into your account. Do what you want to as an organic farmer. So some argue that this actually carries moral hazard and so on. But the important part is, when you're spending that money, which is public funds, you're not really investing it on components that will make the program more impactful and sustainable. There's no investment on institution building, for instance. And organic farming, more than, I would say, competitive chemical farming, requires collaborations, requires a lot of peer support and so on. That is right now missing in most scheme design. And there's, of course, some perspective-related shortcomings. You may agree with me, you may not agree with me. The entire Northeast program is designed for export markets. And it is not meant for the domestic market in India. And we have had some papers showing that monocultures that used to exist in farmers, polycultures that used to exist in farmers' fields are getting replaced by monocultures of ginger and a few other crops after the entry of this scheme and after a farmer has been enrolled into that MOCDNER program. Implementation in a state like Kerala. Kerala has had a fantastic policy on paper. When it drew up the policy, it actually did elaborate processes, and even processes and consultations wise, it did a very good job. But today, because the state is not able to handle the implementation part, they just outsource it somewhat, indiscreetly, without discretion. You know, anyone who can submit a proposal, they're getting it for implementation. On the other hand, you have other states which are implementing both PKVY and regular farming interventions, and you find the same frontline persons going and speaking to the same set of farmers in two different languages. That's the other extreme. So we really caught in certain implementation related challenges also. But the one departure that we see is the Andhra Pradesh CMNF program, which has farmer to farmer extension system as its main emphasis, and that seems to be making a difference. A lot of practicing women farmers are extension agents for other farmers to be enrolled into the program, and even the financial accountability systems of the salaries being paid for such extension is something that's rooted through the community-based organizations, which turns the extension system on its head. Otherwise, it's an upward accountability for all the agents who are supposed to be doing extension. They are answerable only to their bosses, not to the community. Whereas this program has designed it differently. In terms of organic markets and public investments, the government of course doesn't invest on any large scale awareness campaigns around pesticides and GMOs and other toxic chemicals in our food. They turn a blind eye, and they don't even put out what we think is useful information related to residues in foods that they test. And inevitably you find that in a large coordinated residue testing program that the government has, the data shows very little residue levels in India's food. But if you really compare that data with independent studies on residue testing, or all those stories that we read about export consignments getting rejected because of residue levels and so on, you really start wondering about the accuracy of this data. But even that data is not put out for creating demand for non-chemical, organic, safe food. And as you know, organic supply chains are some of the most dispersed, unintegrated supply chains. The farmers are scattered, there's nothing like your regular trading people, nothing like your wholesale markets. Very often it's a supply chain which is shorter, where a retailer is trying to deal with a whole set of dispersed farmers and multiple commodities. It still remains so to this day. And there's really no investments that happen on the kind of separate storage, separate physical infrastructure of various kinds that's required to keep up the organicity of something that's produced as organic. You know, your separate processing setup, separate go downs. If an organic farmer places her produce in a regular storage unit, it will get fumigated and it will no longer be called organic, right? Starting from there are many issues, and most governments and the central government have not invested on smoothening out various issues in that supply chain. Like I said, the Northeast project is centered around export markets. In the PKVY, there's a little component that is supposed to address the market needs of farmers. It is about publicity, and that they think is a bit of value addition, packaging and so on, that they think will resolve all the marketing issues that organic farming cluster might have. And there's a great mismatch between the number of farmers who are getting certified, which means that it is quality assured organic produce, and the number of farmers who are getting enrolled in the organic farming schemes and programs. So I will come to what we are grappling with at this point of time. In a sense, this talk has come in a timely fashion. We've been struggling with a set of regulations that the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, FSSAI, had brought out in December 2017, and after much lobbying, protests, high court case, several different things, they had essentially slowed down until now, and the regulations will now kick in from first day of 2020. And in a sense, this is timely, and this is the counterintuitive bit that I was talking about. And people who had promoted organic farming, we are fighting against mandatory certification that is now required for any organic food to be sold in the market. This is essentially what this regulation is saying. And across the world, this is how organic food regulation has been approached. This is not to deny that this doesn't happen in China, this doesn't happen in Europe, this doesn't happen in the US and so on. So the government is essentially saying, the food safety regulator is essentially saying, that anything that is to be sold as organic food has to be certified has to have its quality verified by some system or the other. This is what this regulation is saying. And the exact wording is listed there as point one. They use several terms like small, original, producer, direct sales, without clarifying anything for a long time. And the rules say that you have to be certified either under the NPOP system, which is the Commerce Ministry's third-party quality assurance system, or something called the Participatory Guarantee System, PGS India, which is a quality assurance regime that is run by the Agriculture Ministry. You have to be certified under this or that. You have to have the logo put on the package. You have to have traceability for every product out there on the shelf up to the producer level. And you have to comply with insecticide residue levels if you're calling something organic. You also have to get every product endorsed online by FSSAI, every little product. And I can't tell you what a big hassle it is when an organic producer FPO wants to sell its produce to a supermarket, for instance. The supermarket devotes only one shelf in any case, if there are supermarkets which are selling organic. And that supermarket is supposed to have a special interest in the organic produce, that they'll get each product picked up before its expiry date and get it endorsed online by FSSAI. You've got to have a distinct display in terms of shelves, in terms of labels and so on, and some regulation related to imports. This is the sum and substance of what FSSAI brought in. And after much lobbying last year in April, they said, okay, since many objections are being raised by many civil society players and others, up till the 1st of April, we'll make this an enabling regulation. This is not meant for prosecution yet. And they gave a little exemption to aggregators and intermediaries up to 50 lakh rupees who can sell without this mandatory certification requirement. This is mainly the two little concessions that they gave, that we will look at this as an enabling regulation. Two, we will give a little exemption category within all of this. And that will also expire, the enabling regulation bit, in a couple of weeks' time. So what are our issues and concerns with this regulation? One, we believe that certification does not provide foolproof system of quality assurance. We know that certificates can be manipulated quite a bit, if you study the certification regimes that exist in the country, you will understand what I'm talking about. So that's not what will catch what is fake organic. The real litmus test for catching fake organic is actually residue testing in labs. That is the only way how fake organic was caught out in the past also. The second thing is that the government brings in a regulation on a sector which is supposed to provide livelihood solutions, which is supposed to provide, environmental regeneration, which is supposed to provide a solution in the age of climate emergency. Within that context, they are bringing in a regulatory system without the government taking the onus of providing certification to the last organic farmer who is willing to become organic. The government didn't take the responsibility, but they just overnight created a regulatory regime. And both these regimes just can't cater to the requirement of organic farmers in this country. There are only 28 accredited certification agencies which can give third-party certification, and they are pretty expensive. And if a farmer who's third-party certified has to sell even one small lot of 50 kilos to some buyer who's placed an order for, let's say, only one quintal, only 50 kilos, each transaction certificate costs something like 2,000 rupees to 5,000 rupees, one transaction certificate. So this is the kind of certification regime that we have, without addressing the design and implementation issues, without checking whether these regimes can actually cater to all farmers, and without the government saying that we will provide certification support, this regime was brought in. And in the Madras High Court, we have a case where we are arguing that this particular regulation is actually ultra vires the Food Safety Act itself, because the Food Safety Act, under one particular section, excludes, it's not even an exemption clause, it is an exclusion clause from the purview of the law of farmers. Farmers cannot be regulated, and to this day, when pesticides are used and pesticide residues turn up in your food, the FSSAI doesn't do anything with those chemical farmers. But when it comes to organic farmers, they want to say that this is regulatable. And they went on record to say that chemical residues cannot be regulated by us at the farmer level because it is not in the purview of the Act. So they are using two different standards, two different approaches to two sets of farmers. And our whole contention is, why are you penalizing one set of farmers who are struggling to provide better farming for this country for future? So what we find is that if these certification regulations are enforced, that we will actually have a lose-lose situation for both organic farmers and organic consumers, because the retailers may not want to deal with uncertified farmers anymore. They will deal with only big players, and that will mean that many uncertified smallholder organic farmers will be out of the market space, and that's a big concern, and we believe that that doesn't fulfill even FSSAI's own mandate. So what we had actually proposed is this. This is my last slide, I think it is. That India should have, if the concern of the food safety regulator is that organic consumers should not be cheated. When they buy something organic, it shouldn't turn out to be somebody making a quick buck by calling something organic, but by chemical production happening in that produce. We're saying that, can you set up your own standards at the food end and not the farming end? And then try and see whether those standards are being enforced. And organic farming certification should be given enough time by the Agriculture Ministry to set up a diverse system of systems of certification, including panchayat certifying. Today, the PGS India, the Participatory Guarantee System, is not able to cope with all the organic producers who are seeking such certification. Let it evolve independently, the organic farming certification, but do have organic food standards and try and enforce them, and have traceability as that key tool by which quality assurance can be maintained. Backward traceability, not forward traceability, which becomes a big burden on farmers. Our whole contention has been that most policies in this country which favor consumer interests have ended up penalizing farmers. And we see that happening with this organic farming regulation also. In the name of organic consumer interests, you will be killing a nascent sector which requires certain expansion before you can actually enforce regulations of this kind. And in our conversations with the chairperson of the FSSAI, we discovered that one of the reasons why this regulation kicked in is because his wife went and purchased something that was sold as organic food, and she was curious enough to get it tested and found residues. And that's not a reason as to why you think that organic food which is fake organic food, is presenting food safety concerns to citizens of this country. Even fake organic cannot be any more unsafe than the regular conventional produce out there. So is this really a matter of food safety is our argument. And let's see what you all have to react with, if there is any reaction. Because, you know, most people as consumers don't want to be cheated. So their question is, so how do I know that this is organic? And we have these proposals. Let's see whether you agree with them. Thank you so much for giving me this time.